Hey y'all. Happy Ash Wednesday. So, yeah, as Wanda said, just want to make sure you're awake. So last time I talked to you about some basic systems concepts, and we also talked about anxiety and some of the ways that anxiety plays out in churches. And then I asked you to look for triangles in your placement settings that you can bring back and talk about today. Right? So just to give you, just to remind you where we're at. What I want to talk about today for just a little bit is sabotage, because that's something that all of us face all the time. It's really just another way of, it's another expression of anxiety. But just to give you, again, some things to look at and some things to recognize, because it's something that you're going to run into not only in your placement settings, but basically in every aspect of your life at one point or another. And so what I mostly want you to remember about sabotage is that whenever you make a change, there will be sabotage. Sabotage is really another word for homeostasis. Right? Sabotage is just the system trying to go back to what it knows and is comfortable with. It's hard to remember, but most people do not lay awake at night trying to decide how to make you personally miserable, which is what sabotage feels like. But really, from a systems perspective, sabotage is the anxiety of the system in response to change acting out through whoever in the system is the least self-differentiated. So whoever in the system is most prone to get anxious tends to act out the sabotage, and it feels like they're targeting us personally. And sometimes they do come at us personally, right? But it helps us manage them if we understand that what they're really doing is speaking for the larger systemic desire to go back to the way that things used to be. Right? So that's what I'm going to talk about in just a few minutes this afternoon. So some characteristics of sabotage. So when these things happen, you can start saying to yourself, "Oh, I wonder what's going. I wonder what anxiety is going on here. I wonder if this is sabotage." So criticism. People criticize all the time. And they don't necessarily criticize about the change that you've made. So in a congregation, the change might be that worship is at a different time on Sunday morning. And you'll hear some criticism about that, but all of a sudden, the sermon's too long, the choir hasn't practiced enough, the kids are too noisy in church. There's criticism about all of these other things that aren't necessarily connected to the time change. When you start to see lots of criticism popping up in a place, it's worth backing up a minute and saying, now, what is this about really? And it's not really about running around about how long the sermons are and whether the kids are too loud. It's more of an indication of anxiety in the system. Does that make sense? People get increasingly reactive. People withdraw. People overfunction. Committees that normally seem pretty functional, suddenly people are fighting. Again, if you can avoid getting caught in the details of the fights and see it as a global anxiety, it helps a lot. People make triangles. We talked about that some last time. We'll talk about triangles more as we get going today. People get paranoid. That's an expression of anxiety. So, you know, when you've shifted something in a church, all of a sudden you'll start to hear people say things like, "Well, you just came here to close us anyway." Or, you know, so-and-so just has it out for us. Or, it's not our fault that we're not thriving. It's the society at large. It's all their fault, right? So sort of a globalized paranoia. Again, that's an expression of people's anxiety. One of the things that happens with sabotage is people use buzzwords. They say things like, "What we really need here is more communication." So, absolutely. I mean, I don't know that you can ever have too much communication. Right? There's too much information, but I'm not sure there's too much communication. But often when people are saying there's not enough communication, or sometimes when people are saying there's not enough communication, what I think they're really saying is there's not communication saying what I would like to have said. Right? And so if you're changing your worship time, maybe you've announced it in all kinds of ways, And there will still be people when the time changes who say, I didn't know about this, we're not communicating enough. Or who will say, wait a minute, I thought I could trust you as a pastor not to surprise me. Or I thought that we were a team player in this organization and now you want to make this change. When you hear buzzwords like that, they're often a sign of sabotage. They're a way of using a pretty positive term, like team player or trust, to try to catch you and snag you in to their resistance. And the other place you see sabotage is that people start using negative words when they could use positive words. So the church that my husband pastored in central Vermont, there was a woman there who started a Thursday lunch program for folks in town, a free lunch program. It was a great program. She was really powerful and she loved it. She loved it so much that she kind of thought that if you attended that church and you did not take part in the lunch program, you probably were not a very good Christian. Like it was her whole world, right? And so of course she rubbed some people the wrong way. And people started saying things like, geez Louise, is she compulsive about that lunch program? And so it was the job of the staff parish committee and the pastor and other leadership there, when they would hear people saying she's compulsive, to say, yeah, she's really committed. She's really working hard to make this happen. So when people use emotionally laden terms instead of neutral terms, that's a way of ramping up the anxiety. Being really committed to something is not the same as being compulsive about something. Being selfish about something is, you can describe an activity that someone's doing and you can call it selfish or you can call it self-care. You can describe the same thing. A sabotaging frame would describe it as selfish. A neutral frame would describe it as self-care. So you see how those two words can get used? To be honest, the word sabotage is an emotionally laden term. It's because it's really homeostasis. And the reason I call this, I do this presentation on sabotage, is that I found very quickly that if I said, I'm going to do a presentation on homeostasis, nobody would show up. Right? But when I say I'm going to do a presentation on sabotage, people are like, oh, sabotage, I'll come for that. Even though it describes the same thing, it's a much more loaded term. So the thing to remember about all of these is that they're all an attempt to catch you, if you're the leader of a change, to catch you and pull you away from the path of change that you're making. So if you're the person who's identified as sort of the figurehead of a particular systemic change, even if most folks in the congregation or your work setting agree with the change, the sabotage will work through a few folks try to kind of knock you off your game, because if you and the other folks who are leading the change, if you back off, things will go back to the way they used to be, and the sabotage will be successful. So it feels like people are coming at you, or coming at me, I would say. It feels like folks are coming at me personally, but what it really is the system's attempt to get me to pay attention to all those little details, all those little criticisms, or react to the terminology or whatever, and then so that I get distracted from the steps I need to take to keep the change going. Does that make sense? Okay. So that's essentially what sabotage is. So how do you handle it? I think a key thing is to expect it, right? So when you make a change in the system, even if everybody agrees that it's a good idea, don't stop paying attention, because sooner or later, the pushback is going to rise up. When I was serving some churches in the Adirondacks, we merged three little churches into one, and it was great. People loved it. I actually said, and I should never have said this, I don't understand why people are so upset about merging churches. It's pretty easy if you're in the right place at the right time. And it was pretty easy for about 2 years, and then the sabotage kicked in. Well, by 2 years, I was on to something else, you know? So, I mean, I was still at that church, but my attention was focused on other things, so that when people started saying, you know, we're not gonna come to church anymore if we're gonna all worship together, I was completely thrown off base. So if you can expect it and be prepared, it really helps. And if you can focus on the process and not the content. So in that merger situation, what happened was the three churches were in three towns that were next to each other, and there was a creek that ran through all three towns. And so we called the new church the Mill Creek Church because it was a creek that ran through all three towns, which I thought was great. And again, everyone seemed to be on board initially. What happened 2 years later was people started saying, I don't like that name. I just don't think that's a good name. I think I'm not going to be able to come to church anymore if it's still called the Mill Creek Church instead of, we were in the town of Johnsburg, the Johnsburg United Methodist Church, as it had been called for 150 years. I didn't know anything about family systems then, so what we had was a whole lot of congregational meetings about what we should name the church. Right? I totally focused on the content, and I am not proud of this, but it's true. You can look it up in the Upper New York Conference. Well, we ended, the churches were in the towns of Johnsburg, Weavertown, and Riparius, and the name we ended up with was the United Methodist Church of Riparius, Weavertown, and Johnsburg. My joke was that we had a higher letter to parishioner ratio in our name than any other church in the conference, right? Because our name is this long. We probably only had 40 people in church. What I wish now, as I look back on that, is that instead of getting hooked on the name, I had said to some of those folks, let's talk about what's really hard about being in this church with the name being different for you. If I had talked about what does it mean to you to walk into this building that you've walked into for 80 years as one name and now it has a different name, if we'd talked about the process, it would have still been tough, but I think it would have settled out a lot more easily and with a lot less pain. So I keep telling that story hoping other people will learn from my mistakes. It's also really important when you feel like sabotage is going on that you stay engaged, that you stay in touch with the folks who are not any fun to stay in touch with, and you don't have to move in with them, but that you let them know that you're hearing them out, right? And that they at least have your understanding, if not your undivided attention. And this says if you get caught back out for a while, but what I would say is that it's really when you get caught. So when you find yourself unable to be gracious to someone who's being critical about something, that's your chance, your indication that you need to get some time off and be playful if you can with things. Be careful of emotional cutoff of people who just sort of stop coming. Be careful of your own tendency to emotionally cut off. Some of us grow up in families, I know that I did, where if there's a disagreement between two folks, we don't actually talk about this disagreement, we just don't talk to each other, right? So that's how a lot of folks are geared to handle something that isn't comfortable for them. So pay attention to that in yourself and in other folks, and be the person who reaches out to say, let's have coffee, let's sit down and talk, how are you doing, what do you think about what's going on, some of those sorts of things. And sooner or later, the sabotage will get tired. It takes way longer than you think, right? But my theory is that sabotage happens in 100 different ways. Probably 94 of them, we don't really even pay that much attention to. We just sort of deal with it. We just figure someone's having a bad day or whatever. But then there are a few things that really grab us. And those things have a lot to do with who we are as individuals and what our personalities are like. And again, what are the skills that we learned growing up about handling sabotage? So in that merger situation, I had somebody who said right at the beginning, she's like, if you're going to change the name of my church, I'm not going to come to church. Well, I was okay with that. And actually, I didn't mind if she had come to church. But you know, initially, when folks came at me in that kind of aggressive way, I mean, it wasn't comfortable, but I dealt with that fine. Where I got caught 2 years later was because it was the sainted elderly couple of the church who had been so good to me when I had come there. Right? I adored them. And so when they said, we think we're going to stay away because of the name, I got completely snagged. So all of us have our points that we're susceptible to getting caught. But sooner or later, if we can hold our own most of the time, the sabotage will get tired and wear out, and now it's the way things have always been. That merger still has held together these 20 years later. They're still called the United Methodist Church of Repair, as we were telling Johnsburg, but at least they've hung together this time. And then lastly, if we're going to lead change, we need to be comfortable with discomfort. We need to be comfortable with pain, emotional pain, sometimes physical pain, but definitely emotional pain. We need to be comfortable with inflicting that pain on other people. We need, you know, making things uncomfortable for other folks. And we need to be comfortable with our own discomfort that we've made other people uncomfortable. So I'm not saying go out and be mean to people, but I do think that part of being a leader who's going to bring significant change into an institution is knowing that sooner or later you're going to disappoint people and being okay with that. You know, Ron Heifetz at the Harvard School of Business says, adaptive leadership is the art of disappointing people at a rate that they can manage. And that, I think, is probably the truest description of leadership that I know. So that if we can be comfortable with disappointing people and savvy enough to understand what's too fast and what's fast enough, then we can lead folks through to change. You know, Ed Friedman, who wrote the text on how to apply family systems to churches, he welcomed sabotage. He was kind of an odd guy in many ways, but he would say that he would always be happy when he would get sabotage because it was proof that he was doing something that mattered. So you know you're on the right track if you're making a change that's significant enough that people are pushing back. I would say it's a little more, I would be more careful than that. Sometimes I think we make change and then we get sabotaged back and we realize, maybe this wasn't the time, or maybe this is too much of a change. And so I like to be thoughtful about how we go forward. But the most important thing, I think, for us as leaders is to know that sooner or later there's going to be pushback, and when we make a change, it always gets harder before it gets easier. That, I think that's really important. And then at the bottom of your handout, I put just a few pieces about handling ourselves as leaders, just as reminders. So focus on yourself and not on others. Right? So pay attention, like listen to other folks, but pay attention mostly to managing your own anxiety and your own self. Always be working so that you know what you think about something, so that you know why you believe something is important, so that you are managing your own anxiety in a system. When you are present with other folks, be the person who reaches out and makes connections to them. Be present in the system and engaged in the system. So when you're at the meeting, being the person who speaks up. Use all the stuff we've talked about, right? Understand the system. Make sure that you take action. I always say if you just analyze the system and understand where all the anxieties are and then you don't do anything to change anything, now you're just exquisitely miserable in the same system. So make sure that you put some of it into place. And I think this is most key. Play to the strengths of the people you're working with and play to your own strengths. It's so tempting to pay most of our attention to the people who are the most dependent and who are the most difficult because they're the loudest. And often they're the folks who are at our door all the time. But be looking for who are the healthiest people in the system that can understand what we're doing and can be allies. I work with a group of clergy in Vermont. We've been working together for about 15 years, and we do case studies with each other every time that we get together, and one of the things we're always saying is, okay, we set up this whole situation, we understand what's going on, who are the healthy people that we haven't talked about yet? Because usually when we're talking about a situation, we're talking about all the people who are really difficult. Okay, we're not discounting those, but let's make sure we include the health in the system. questions around any of that? This is the quiet group. I remember that from last time. Yeah.
How much of this presupposes an amount of verbal skill? Can someone differentiate well, show up and be accounted for, articulate what they think, and be more introspective, for example, or
it absolutely.
How does that change the whole equation?
If there aren't good verbal skills.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the church that I was at in the Adirondacks, there were very few people in those churches that had more than a high school education, and many of them did not have that. And so the level at which we could engage things was different because of that, like what people understood as a well-run meeting or how to show up at something. But that didn't necessarily impact the way that I acted. So when I would say playing to the strengths of the individuals, I wouldn't necessarily expect people to be great at articulating feelings. I would try to be connected enough to them that I could ask them questions in ways that made sense to them. Does that help?
Sure.
You have to kind of pitch it. And another example out of those churches is I came in and I was doing a Bible study with these wonderful Adirondack ladies who are all, you know, my grandmother's age. And I said, we're going to do a Bible study on strangers in the Bible and how important it is to welcome the alien. And so first, I'd like to have all of us talk about a time when you've been a stranger someplace. And they all looked at me and they said, we've never been a stranger someplace. Because they were all in the towns. Some of them were born in the house that their grandparents had been born in, right? Many of them had hardly ever been out of their county, right? Like going to the hospital was the only place that they were, it seemed like a stranger to them. And that's when I thought, this Bible study is not going to work here. Right? Because I don't know these people well enough to know how to talk. I got to that material later on, but first I had to be able to ask them questions that actually related to them. So the same thing with emotional process. You can't necessarily ask someone who does logging for a living, you know, how do you feel about this? Right? I mean, sometimes you can, and I don't want to stereotype folks. But it might be more like saying to them, what makes why is this making you mad? Why is this making you mad? You know, so ways to talk about it in that way. And again, for ourselves to model what we're looking for is really important. Other questions? Yeah.
I'm curious about to what degree as a leader you share your knowledge of a system with others in the system.
I think it's great to share it, and again, it requires a fair amount of introspection. Not everybody gets it, but I think with personnel committees or staff parish committees, lay leaders in other organizations, HR committees, to be able to talk about systems and what a triangle is and what happens in anxiety, it's great if there could be a lot of folks who are aware of that.
Do you talk theoretically about this, or is it ever appropriate to say this thing is occurring here amongst us?
Yeah. I think both are fine. It depends on the situation. Right? It's great if you can do some of the teaching theoretically, but provided you can do it in a pastoral way, I think using concrete examples is good. And I teach this in congregations around New England. And when I talk about triangles and I say that piece about you can't affect a relationship that you're not part of, it's amazing to watch people go, oh. And you know, they're scrolling through situations in their own heads. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I think it's fine. A lot of times I'll use video clips or I'll use movies. And we can, because it's more fun to apply it to somebody else. And so we can practice. I'm going to do that with you a little bit. So, yeah.
Would you elaborate a little more about emotional system? What do you mean by emotional system?
So when I talk about emotional system, I mean everybody who's involved in a, I'll just say church, and you can apply it to whatever setting you're in. And the emotional system is the way that people are connected with each other. Both verbally and how they're picking up each other's nonverbal messages. When I talked about this 2 weeks ago, if you remember right, there was a drawing that had all these green arrows between people. That's the emotional, the green arrows is the emotional system. question. Yeah.
I mean, I can't help but think about the, like, cyclical process of, so you come in as possibly a new leader, and you know, change occurs, and then after a while, right, a new homeostasis. As a leader, if you intentionally kind of always keeping maybe the system a little, so that it can't fall back into kind of that place of homeostasis. I don't know if I'm articulating that clearly. I'm just trying to think about how ways to kind of maybe avoid the painful process. So maybe you can't. Maybe the community will always have to. There's just so much change.
Yeah. You know, it completely depends on the system, right? So some groups of people are already pretty anxious, right? And so just a little change in that system will get them comfortable. On the other hand, if you can make some changes kind of over time, you kind of build up people's dealing with change muscles. And that, I think it really is a strength that a system can learn over time, provided there's a leader who keeps introducing change as you go. I don't know that you can ever make it easy, completely easy. But I do think it's a skill. It's a learned skill. And one of the things that can be helpful after a church has gone through a really difficult situation, or an organization has dealt with a difficult personnel situation or something, for the leadership to kind of sit down and say, okay, that was really hard. What are some things we learned? And then the next time something kicks up, you can say, remember that time when we got through that thing and we got through it okay? Let's try to apply. You know, so it's an ongoing learning.
Scenario where the leadership initiates a change, but it's actually the wrong change for that particular population,
sure.
And that the sabotage may in fact be justified.
Absolutely.
That would never happen.
Well, and that's one of the reasons why when Ed Friedman says, welcome sabotage is a sign of progress, I want to say, well, I mean, yes and no, right? It's because sometimes, and I have to confess, I've been guilty of this, I've come in really clear about what I thought the change should be, and it wasn't the right change for that place. And so when stuff kicks up, it's worth paying attention to say, is this just resistance, or is this telling me that I need, that this is not the right change for this time? And I think one of the things that's really helpful is having people you can talk to. So checking out, you know, if even the most mature people in a congregation are saying, then I would be more inclined to say maybe this is a great place for what that's worth. All right, well, let me show you a little video clip about sabotage. So this is the movie Seabiscuit. So Seabiscuit was a racehorse in the United States in the 1930s. And it's a great movie, if you get a chance. It's a great book as well. But what you need to know about this particular clip is Jeff Bridges plays the owner of this horse. He's a man who's made his fortune in the new automobile industry, and then his only child is killed in a car accident, and his marriage dissolves. And so the thing that's the source of his wealth is also the source of his greatest pain. In the movie, he ends up remarrying. We'll see his new wife in it here. As he works through his grief, he decides to get into horse racing and to give himself something to do. So he finds this horse named Seabiscuit that's really small for a racehorse, that's really fast, but also has a really bad attitude, right? It's really hard to get this horse to race well. He hires a trainer who is kind of a horse whisperer. He's really good with horses. He's really bad with people, and so he's been fired from all kinds of racing organizations because he doesn't have any people skills, even though he's good at getting horses to do things. And he hires a jockey who's played by Tobey Maguire, whose nickname is Red, because he has red hair. And Red's story is that his family has lost their home in the Depression, and they're literally walking the roads of California with all of their belongings in pillowcases, many of them books. And as he's a teenager, and as his family realizes that he has a gift for riding horses, they abandon him at a horse farm. They tell him they'll come back, and they never do, because they're pretty sure that he can get a job here and he'll get fed. They're actually taking care of him, but it doesn't feel like that. So Red is a jockey who's pretty good, but he's got kind of a chip on his shoulder. He's got some anger management issues. So we have a grieving horse owner. We've got a small horse with a bad attitude. We've got a trainer who's good with horses, not so good with people, and then a jockey with anger management issues. And this scene is the very first horse race that they're doing. So they've been together for about a year, they've been training, they've been getting ready, and this is their first public race. And the words go kind of quick, so I'm going to put it up in the subtitles.
As long as we're talking long shots, I got a real doozy for you folks. Today we got our horses going off at 70-1, and that's a short price, my friends. This horse couldn't win a church raffle, let alone a $2,000 allowance. Yeah, talk about a jump in class. This is the skull to the garden party. Yes, he's the surprise in the punch bowl. As a matter of fact, I'll lay even money that this nag Sea Biscuit couldn't even finish 6 furlongs. This is Tick Tock McLaughlin Live at Clunker's Corner.
I want a maroon. They only have bright red.
Oh, that's great.
You don't think the age is too big?
Have you seen the size of our jockey?
Okay, my favorite's that gray over there. He's got a big late charge, so locking early with him and stay right off his plank.
Okay.
Once our boy sees who the competition is, he'll do most of the work. But don't move till that gray does.
What if it's late?
I don't think it's gonna matter much. Honestly.
Come on. do you think?
He fouled me. What am I supposed to do? Let him get away with that?
Well, yeah, when he's 40-1.
He almost put me in the rail.
Well, did he? Look, we had a plan.
He fouled me, Tom. What am I supposed to do? He cut me off. He fouled me!
Son, what are you so mad at?
Nobody's even a phone next door. We'll call, every couple of weeks we'll call you and we'll tell you we'll go on.
I need to borrow some money.
All right.
I haven't been to a dentist. And I need to borrow some money.
That's fine.
I don't know when I can pay you back. I mean, when we win. When we win, I can pay you back. That is, if you're still on the ride.
Of course I want you to ride. How much do you need?
$10.
$10?
Thank you. I really appreciate it.
Maybe an easier thing to say is, what got sabotage? Yeah.
Well, the race did when Red got mad at just this other guy being rude, essentially, in the race. And so he focused on that instead of staying on track.
Right, so he got caught in the content, right? He totally lost the bigger picture. And afterwards, when he's saying, what am I supposed to do, let him cut me off? And the owner says, well, when he's 40-1, yeah, you let him cut you off. But, right, so he got, and why, well, let me do this way. So we see Red and the trainer and the owner talking afterwards. So they're a triangle, right? And the trainer is really mad at Red, right? Because he sabotaged the race, right? The trainer keeps saying, we had a plan, right? I gave you the plan, right? And Red didn't follow it, right? So this is a cutoff sign. That's a connection sign. This is an anxiety sign. This is a really common triangle between these two people in this plan. And Red, what's your, again, you said Red, you got, he let the guy cut him, when that guy cut him off, he reacted back, right? Presumably, the owner knows about the plan, too, at some level. So the trainer keeps saying to Red, you didn't follow the plan, you didn't follow the plan. What does the owner say to Red? Say it again?
He asks him why he's so angry.
What are you so mad at, right? So the owner says, why are you so mad? Because I think the owner gets it, that it's because of stuff, it's because of what he's so angry at that he doesn't stick with the plan, right? And the owner doesn't really know what that is, right? A dashed line is kind of a loose connection, right? And, you know, to his credit, Red goes and he works on what he's so mad at. What he's mad at is being abandoned by his parents, among other things, right? The next race, he's a whole different guy, right? He's seeing the big picture. He's saying things to his horse like, we've got all the time in the world, which seems like an odd thing to say on a horse when you're hurtling around a track as fast as you can go. But he's calm, and because he's calm, the horse is calm too. So Red's, his old pain, his old anxiety, his old homeostasis sabotages the plan. One of the reasons I like this clip as an illustration of sabotage is it's not that Red did that on purpose. He didn't wake up that morning and say, now what could I do to throw my job in jeopardy? He got caught up and he ended up reacting back. And I think that's often what happens in sabotage with folks. It's not that they're designing it. Is that they're reacting against something that's caught them someplace that maybe we aren't necessarily aware of. It doesn't mean you have to let people get away with it, but it helps if you can understand there's a bigger picture to it. Questions about that or other, anything else as we go forward? You know, I think the other piece that I would say really helps Red in the next race is not only does he work on his own anger issues, though they wouldn't have said that in 1930, right? But also the owner reaffirms their connection. You know, he goes and asks him for money, and $10 in 1930 was an amazing amount of money, right? And the owner gives him $20. I don't know if you could see that from where you were on the screen. Because the owner strengthens their connection here, Red is better able to follow through on the plan the next time because he knows that he's safe, right? He doesn't have to be as on edge as he is. One of my goals in life is to always enter into difficult situations with that kind of wisdom and aplomb that Jeff Bridges shows, where he says, what are you so mad at, right? Instead of, I can't believe you just did this, right? So what I would like you to do in your IFT groups, is that right?
ITP, yeah.
ITP. ITP groups, okay. I don't know what it stands for, and that's why I can't. That's why I can't remember the letters. In your ITP groups is to talk about triangles in your own field placement settings. I talked with the facilitators beforehand. What I'd like you to do is draw them out on the back of your handout or somewhere. There's also a bibliography on the table. You can use that paper if you want. As I was talking to the groups, and we were saying, well, how do you draw that out? So here's another example of triangles. When I was first learning about family systems, I realized that I was involved in a triangle between me, my husband, and the church that he was pastoring. I wasn't pastoring a church at that time, I was a conference staff. And so I was attending his church. And my husband pastors well, and he pastors very differently than I do, right? And things between me and him had been a little spiky lately, and I realized at one of those first family systems things that I went to is that one of the problems was because I was trying to change the way he pastored his church. I wasn't that direct, right? I would just sort of always drop hints about things, or after to worship I'd say, you know, you could have done, just, you know, a really horrible thing to do somewhere in worship. But I was trying to affect the side of a triangle that wasn't mine to affect, and so it was making things squiggly with me and him. And also I realized that I'd never really thought through my side of this side of the triangle. I hadn't really thought about what does it mean for me to be a pastor and to be sitting in the pew in my husband's church? What's my relationship with the church here? I've been doing my relationship by trying to work around the triangle this way. So I went home from that workshop, got a lot clearer on what I wanted my contribution to the church to be, stopped trying to push my husband for the way I thought he ought to pastor his church, and this settled out a lot more easily. So that's, again, an example of if you can draw out the triangle, you can start to see some of the relationships that you're caught in. That makes sense? All right, so I will stop talking, and I'll let you guys do your thing.